faith that is misplaced is not faith at all.
This morning, I want to share with you something that is very dear to me and very special. I'm going to continue speaking on the theme of faith, but before we do that, I think it is good to remind ourselves of the conclusion we arrived at last night. Last night we discovered that no matter how sincere you might be, if your faith is misplaced, then you'll never experience the joy of the rewards of your faith. If your faith is misplaced, if your faith is in yourself, no matter how much you believe in yourself, it is not that kind of faith that moves mountains. But if our faith is centered in God, then at His instruction, we can move things according to His will. The scripture reading for today, taken from Luke chapter 18, verse 8. This is the account where Jesus was with the disciples in the boat. And the waters began to get rough. Jesus was asleep in the boat. The disciples began to panic. The account in the Bible says the boat began to fill with water. And so one of the disciples went to Jesus, shook him and woke him up and said, "Master, do you not care that we might perish here in this storm?" Jesus looked at them. And in Mark chapter 4, Jesus turns to his disciples and he says, "Have I not been with you for so long?" And then Jesus says, "O ye of little faith," just after he commands the winds and the waves to remain still. When Jesus calms the winds and the waves, and thereafter speak to the disciples, he asks them the question, "Where is your faith?" And in Luke chapter 18, an interesting, a very interesting verse, the Bible says, "When the Son of Man comes a second time, will he find faith on the earth?" I've heard many people talking about many requirements to prepare for the second coming of Jesus Christ. Yes, one of the requirements I've heard people preaching is that you need to keep yourself healthy, and there is a strong movement for us to be vegetarians. I subscribe to the health message of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, just in case any one of you is wondering if I am prescribing something else. But I want you to know that you can be a vegetarian as much as you want, to the extent that you become a vegetable itself. But we will not be saved because of our vegetarianism. It will make you healthy, but it will not save you. When the Son of Man comes the second time, the Bible says God is looking for a particular trait in His people. And that trait that He is looking for is faith. And so I thought it would be good to explore a little bit what exactly this faith is about. Today I want to present to you about faith. And I want to say very categorically that believing is not faith. I've asked many people the definition of faith, and they said to believe in God. I've come to the conclusion that belief alone is not faith, does not constitute what faith really is. And I wanted to see whether the thoughts in my mind were in line with the scriptures. Because if whatever you think is not in line with the Bible, then you need to throw it out of your mind.
Because it is this word that is our rule of faith. We don't live according to what we think. We live and move and exist and have our being in Christ, and we get our marching orders from the Word of God. And so I began to explore the Bible very simply as a child would. And in Hebrews chapter 11 verse 8, the Bible says, "But Abraham, when he was called, he obeyed to go out to a place that he was to receive as an inheritance, and he went out not knowing where he was going." The name Abraham, father of the faithful, has been included in the hall of faith of Hebrews chapter 11, because the Bible records that Abraham obeyed. Abraham heard the voice of God. He believed it was the voice of God, but it was only when Abraham obeyed did Abraham have faith. Even the devil believes. Belief does not constitute faith. When we began to read the Bible further, and in Matthew chapter 8, verse 26, Jesus speaking, he says, "Oh, why are you so fearful, oh ye of little faith?" And Jesus raises his hands, commands the winds and the waves to be still. You will notice that in the Bible, in Matthew chapter 9, verse 2, you remember the story of the paralytic? This man was paralyzed, lying on his bed. His friends wanted to bring him to Jesus, and they realized that the room was full. The entrance of the house was full to capacity. They went up to the roof, removed the tiles or whatever was on the roof, and they let their friend down. The Bible says, when Jesus saw their faith, he healed the man. I believe with all my heart that before the friends brought him to Jesus, they believed that Jesus could heal him. They believed at home. But it is only when they acted on what they believed, it was regarded as faith. You can believe as much as you want, but if you don't act on your belief, your belief will remain as belief. Don't say it is faith. Faith is only faith when you act on your belief. To believe is passive, but faith is active. If you don't act on what you believe, you have just a good belief, but you don't have faith. I think about the story of the woman who was suffering with the issue of blood for 12 years. She heard that Jesus was coming into her village that day. And I can imagine, for 12 years, she was plagued with this sickness. And when she heard that Jesus was coming to town, she said, "If I could go to him and just touch the hem of his garment, I would be made whole." This woman believed at home. If she could be healed based on her belief, she could have been healed while she was at home. But she acted on her belief and came to Jesus, touched the hem of his garment, and Jesus told her, "My daughter, your faith has made you whole." You will read the Bible from cover to cover, and you will never find at any point where people were healed because they believed, but they were healed because they had faith. Faith is derived from belief, but it is only when you act on what you believe that your belief becomes faith. If you don't act on your belief, then all you have is a good belief, but no faith. My son, when he was about 5 years old, one day I went to church very early. This day I went to church. I just bought a new car, the first time in my life. So I went to church with my new car. I thought if I go early, you know, people would ask whose car this is. And then I would have to tell them very humbly, you know, it is my car. But while I was at the end of my sermon, I was shaking the members' hands. My son ran through the crowd, came to me. I thought he was excited to see me. He was running with his friends, and he came to me and he says, "Dad, give me the keys." I said, "What keys, son?" He said, "No, my car keys." So I said, "Your car?" He says, "Yeah, where's the keys?" So I took my keys and I gave it to my son. And I told him, he was just 5 years old, I told him, "Please, don't drive very fast and don't go anywhere." But he took his friend to the car and he began to show off this car with his friend, explaining to him certain things in the car according to his knowledge. He was having a fun time being excited about this car. But what intrigued me is the sense of ownership that my son had over a car that does not belong to him. It amazed me. It amazed me. So one day he goes to school, when he went to school, and they were asking for somebody to sponsor computers in the school. So my son raises his hand and he asks the teacher, "How many do you want?" And the teacher says, "We need only two." He said, "That's no problem. My father will give you two." So he comes home and he says, "Dad, guess what?" Ask him, "What, son?" He says, "I just told the school that you are going to give them two computers." I said, "Really?" He said, "No, what?" I asked him, "What computers, son?" He said, "No, give them the latest computer, Dad." I said, "Really?" I said, "How do the school know that I will give them this computer?" I told them. I said, "You told them?" I told him, "Yeah." So I asked him, "Why did you tell them?" I said, "Come on." He said, "Come on, Dad." You know, a small boy. He said, "Come on, Dad. It's just two computers." When my son was there shaking my hand, I overheard him telling his friend, "I told you, come and see my car." My son may not have understood the concept, but faith brings you to a point where you own what your father owns. Faith brings you to a point. No wonder the Bible says we should become like little children. When your faith comes to that point of a little child, when you realize that all that belongs to the Father belongs to you, then you will be able to say, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." You will be able to move the bottle, not because you can move the bottle, but because of your relationship with the one who can. The bottle will move for you. You see, faith is only faith if you act on what you believe. I believe it. And that's why I preach it. Faith can only be faith if it is an action dependent on what you believe. Our problem is that we have become so rational that our faith has stopped being radical. We have stopped asking God what He wants for us. We have been prescribing to God. We have been deliberating and giving God our conclusions rather than asking God what He wants for us. The paralytic was healed because of faith. His friends acted on what they believed, and it was regarded as faith, and he was healed. The woman with the issue of blood acted on what she believed. She came to Jesus. And when you act on what you believe, your belief is transformed into faith. And God rewards you for your faith. You know, you can pray as much as you want to pray. But if you don't act in line with your prayer, then you don't even believe what you prayed. Because faith is when you act on what you believe. And you can pray and say, you can kneel down and say, Lord, you know, because some people believe only when you kneel down, your prayer is more holy. Lord, you know, this girl, oh, I love her so much, Lord. She doesn't know it as yet, but I love her so much, Lord. And you can stay in your room and pray and pray and pray. That girl will marry somebody else. Because you can believe that she is the one for you. But if you don't act in accordance with what you believe, your faith will never be rewarded. Faith, yes, the foundation of faith is belief. But if you don't act on what you believe, your belief will just be a good belief. The Bible says in Exodus chapter 14, verse 15, Moses was leading the Israelites. As he was moving them, leading them, he came to the Red Sea. The Egyptians were pursuing them. The Israelites were complaining. Moses goes to have a conversation with God. And God tells Moses, Moses, why are you crying to me? Go down and tell the people to move forward. That's all. Moses goes down and he tells the people, let's move forward. And when they took their step forward, the Red Sea parted and they walked on dry land. As long as they stayed on this side, on the shores of the Red Sea, and even if they believed, even if they sang and they danced, had special items and prayed, praising God for who He is, recounting that God created ex nihilo out of nothing, their belief would remain a good belief and the Red Sea would remain closed for them. It's only when you act on what you believe does the Red Sea part for you. They acted on what they believed and the Red Sea parted for them. It's amazing what happens when we start believing. What happens when we act on what we believe. In the book Great Controversy, page 525, one of my favorite quotations is found. God will answer if we ask. It is part of God's plan to grant us in answer to the prayer of faith that which He would not bestow had we not asked. I wanted to find out, how exactly does this idea of faith work? And I began to read and explore a little bit. and I discovered another wonderful statement, that our blessings will be in proportion to our faith. And I want you to listen to this quotation. Pray in faith and be sure to bring your lives into harmony with your petitions, that you may receive the blessings for which you pray. Ellen White continues by saying, let not your faith weaken, for the blessings received are proportionate to the faith exercised. According to your faith, so shall it be. All things whatsoever you shall believe and ask in prayer, you shall receive. I wanted to find out, what exactly did she mean when she said that our blessings will be in proportion to what we ask and our faith? And then she says, after you pray, bring yourself into harmony with your petitions. To help illustrate this, let me just say, let's say I want to pray in my mind, I want to pray, Lord, all of you have your chair, right? So I want to pray, Lord, I also want my chair. And this is the chair that I want. See this chair? This is the chair that I want. Let's say I want this chair here. The Bible says, if you ask in faith and believe, you shall receive. And then I go on my knees and I say, Lord, hallelujah, there is none like you. Oh God, you are wonderful. You spoke the world into existence. You said, let there be light, and there was light. Lord, I'm not asking for any big thing today. I'm only asking for one white chair, Lord. You open your eyes, and your chair is not there. So you remember the parable of the persistent widow? So you go on and pray again, Lord, I ask again, Lord, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. I want this white chair, Lord. Let me tell you, you can be on your knees and pray and pray and pray. You're not going to get the white chair. Ellen White says, you need to get up from your knees and align your steps in accordance to what you have prayed. This is what faith is, dear brothers and sisters. I have faith that the chair I am praying for exists and it is here. I walk from there. I carry my chair. I feel it, place it on my shoulder, feel the weight. I even sit on it a little while. By faith, huh? Remember, I'm still there. This is all happening in my heart and in my mind. I experience it. And I go back here. And when I come back to my position of prayer, I don't just pray now. I say, Lord, thank you. Thank you for answering my prayer. How can I thank God for something that I don't have as yet? It's because I have prayed in faith. And in faith, I have tasted, I have felt, I have held that which I am praying for. After I have prayed now, I know where my chair is. So I align my steps and I go straight towards my chair. Huh? Pick my chair up and say, thank you, Jesus. And I take my chair now. And everyone knows this year is my chair. I prayed for it. I did not have it a few seconds ago, but now it is mine. So I can enjoy that which I have prayed for. You can pray as much as you want to pray. That chair is not going to walk from there, even though it has twice the amount of legs that you have. That chair is not going to walk from there and come to you. Ellen White says, after you have prayed in faith, You got to get up from your knees and align your steps according to that which you have prayed. And in this way, your prayers will become a reality. Because I believe yesterday's prayers, God has already started answering them the day before yesterday. But we are waiting for Him to answer it in the fashion that we want Him to answer. If it is not active, my dear friends, it is not faith. If it is not active, it is just not faith. If I ask how many of you believe, I am sure most of us will put our hands up. But if I ask how many of us have faith, it would be a different story. There are people who believe that Jesus is God, but they have no faith. Because if you have faith and you believe that Jesus is God, then you will worship Him. If you believe that the Sabbath is on the seventh day and you want to exercise faith, then you will keep the Sabbath. It's as simple as that. If you believe with your mind, but you don't act on what you believe, it is not constituted as faith. A very interesting scholar and philosopher in the 1200s, Thomas Aquinas, wrote, "To one who has faith, no explanation is necessary. To one without faith, no explanation is possible." There are certain things that can only be experienced and grasped by faith. Faith is not belief without proof, but it is trust without reservation. Faith is experienced not on your knees, but is experienced on your feet. Faith is not experienced by being passive about what you believe. Faith is when you activate your faith, your belief. You know, you can go and buy some airtime, huh? And you will get a pin on a piece of card. And you have to scratch that pin and punch it into your phone. You can go and buy it and have it in your pocket and say, "I have airtime." And so let's make a call. "No, I can't make a call." And you ask, "Do you have airtime?" "Yes, I have airtime." It's only when you scratch that pad and punch it in that is your belief credited as faith. And you act on that and you make your call. Faith, dear friends, is not belief. Belief needs to be activated in order for it to be constituted as faith. I met my wife many years ago. I celebrated my 22nd wedding anniversary a few weeks ago. So I knew my wife for a long time. And if I had in my mind thought, if this woman, at that time she was a girl, if this girl is the one that God has for me, the Lord will impress upon her and she will come to me, I might have remained a bachelor all my life. But if I believed that she was the one, then I needed to act on my belief and go to her. And the rest is still history in the making. Because when you act on what you believe, amazing things happen. The woman with the issue of blood, she believed at home that Jesus could heal her. She believed. She acted on her belief and she was made whole. The paralytic and his friends, they believed that Jesus could heal him.
And they brought him to Jesus, and Jesus healed him. Blind Bartimaeus, who was blind, running around depending on other people, when he heard about Jesus, he knew that Jesus could heal him. He believed that Jesus could heal him. And when he sensed and heard the people going towards Jesus, because Jesus was nearby, he screamed on top of his voice, saying, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." He acted on what he believed was possible, and Jesus healed blind Bartimaeus. Zacchaeus, when he decided to see Jesus, he went up upon the tree, and while he was on the tree, he acted on what he thought was right. And at that moment on the tree, Jesus went past and he said, "Zacchaeus, come down. We are going to your house today to have something to eat." Zacchaeus came down. He acted on his belief, and his belief was transformed into faith. I can go on and on with example after example in the Bible where people believed, but their belief constituted faith after they acted on their belief, and then miracles took place. You remember the first miracle that Jesus performed? He turned water into wine. His mother was at the wedding feast. There was a shortage of wine, and his mother came to Jesus and said, "Please do something." Jesus told her, "My time has not come as yet." But the mother believed Jesus could do something. She went to the servants and told the servants, "Just do whatever he asked you to do." They filled those jars of water. And I can imagine Mary in her mind saying, "What's going to happen?" Her heart must have been pounding, waiting for this miracle to take place. She believed it. And because she believed it, she went to ask Jesus. And that day, water turned to wine. When you act on what you believe, amazing things will happen for you. I want to share with you one personal story that I shared last night with a few young people. When I was a student at Spicer Memorial College, my wife used to do summer school while I used to come back to South Africa and work there so that I can pay for her school fees and mine as well. You know, when you get married, young men, get married with the idea that you have to take care of your wives, because you are supposed to protect your wife. If you can't, don't get married. Don't make somebody's life miserable because you are miserable. Huh? Stay single and enjoy it. But when you get married, there is responsibilities that come with it. One of those responsibilities is to care for your family financially. So I used to come down and work. And I got into a taxi from Durban to Johannesburg. When I got into this taxi, the taxi driver was collecting the taxi fares from everybody. When he came to me, I simply told him, "Is it all right if I pay you when I arrive at the destination?" Which was about 6.5 hours away. He agreed. So we went together with, I think, maybe 16 other passengers. Halfway after 3.5 hours, we stopped at a garage. People bought things to eat. I went into the toilet. I brushed my teeth. And I came back into the taxi, sat there, about to leave. There was a gentleman who was sitting in the front seat with the driver and another passenger. And he asked the driver, "Can I please swap seats with someone at the back of the taxi?" The driver said, "Listen, all of you selected your seats when you came into the taxi. So I cannot instruct someone to swap with you unless one of them agrees." Lo and behold, the lady who was sitting next to me, she said, "I'll go." And she got up and they swapped seats. This man who came from the front of the taxi to sit with me at the back now, I was sitting here and he was sitting next to me. The moment I saw him, I was suspicious. Because why will a guy be excited to sit next to another guy? In my mind, I couldn't put these two things together. So when he came to sit near me, I very discreetly pulled my one leg to myself, to keep everything together where I was. And then this man did the thing that I dreaded the most. He put his hand on my leg, touched me. Yeah. I don't like when men touch me. If my wife touched me, it's okay. She can touch me wherever she wants to touch me, but man touching me, it's not good, my friend. It's not good. Imagine if I come to you while I talk to you, I said, "I hope you are fine." It's not, just not right, huh? It's just not right. As guys, we must be able to shake our hand, trick man. Must be able to shake our hand, maybe tap each other on the back, stand up, give each other a hug. Don't hug each other and hold each other. No. It's just not the way it was supposed to be. All right? So when this guy put his hand on my thigh, pulled my leg to me, I looked at him and said, "Yes?" He said, "Tell me, would you mind?" I wanted to say, "No, I do mind." But he said, "Would you mind if I give you something?" When he said that, I said, "No problem." He put his hand in his pocket. He took out a 100 rand note. As soon as I saw the money, I took it out of his hand, put it in my pocket. Without him completing the story. Huh? Because now it's in my pocket, huh? Can you imagine if another man is coming to put his hand in your pocket? It doesn't look nice, huh? I can scream and say, "This man is harassing me," or something. It's in my pocket, it's mine. Then he tells me the story. He says, "When I was sitting in the front, a voice was telling me, I need to go and sit at the back. When I came and sat at the back, the same voice was telling me to give you this money. Now that I've given you this money, it's as if a whole burden has been lifted from my shoulder." I said, "Oh, okay. I hope that's all the voice told you." In my mind, I was thinking it, huh? And here he was. The next moment I turned to him, he was fast asleep. I was pretending to sleep all this while. Pretending to sleep. When I saw him sleeping, I opened my eyes. I looked out of the window, looked into the sky. Because for him, it was just a voice. But for me, I knew who the voice came from. This man was a Hindu man. Listening to the voice to give 100 rands to a Christian brother. So he gave it to me. At that moment of my life, I realized that if God wants to accomplish his purposes, he will use whoever he wants to use. He will use whatever he wants to use. The choice of instrument is dependent on the one who created, and he is our God. When we jumped off at our destination, the taxi driver asked me for my fare. I put my hand in my pocket very confidently, took out the 100 rand note, the only money that I had. I gave it to him. He gave me my 20 rand change, and I went on my way. In my heart, I could not explain to anyone. I myself, for a moment, did not understand what I was doing. But I was fully convinced. I believed with all my heart that because God wanted me to be in Johannesburg, that he will provide the means for me to get there. Rational minds would say, go and ask some money so that you can pay. Rational minds would say, go and borrow the money with the promise that you will return it. But the mind of faith says, act on what you believe, because how is not a problem for God. How is God's specialty? How it will take place is God's problem, not your problem. Our problem is that we are hesitant to act on what we believe. When I got into that taxi without any money, I did not tell anyone because I don't believe anyone would believe me. But I knew somewhere, I don't know how, I don't know when, I don't know when it will happen, whether at the end or yeah, I had no idea how it will happen, but I believe it will happen. And I got my taxi fare when I got into the taxi without any money in my pocket. My dear friends, I can go on telling you stories of what happens when you act on what you believe. But you know why I am so excited about speaking about faith? It's not because I read it in a textbook or anything. I have tasted and I have seen that the Lord is good and his mercies endure forever. And you might be thinking, you just have a small story to say about how the Lord gave you 100 rands, huh? Me, I have a bigger story to say. Huh? Maybe the Lord gave you 100,000 rands or whatever. I don't know what he has blessed you with. I don't know what your faith is. I don't know where you are in the continuum of faith. I don't know what your experience is. All I know is that when you act on what you believe, and if your belief is placed correctly, miracles will happen. What happens when you act in faith? What is the reward of faith? That is what we are going to talk about this afternoon. What is the reward of faith? But for now, I want you to know that if you believe, it is good. Believing is just the first step. You have to act on what you believe. You know why you need to act on what you believe? Because Luke chapter 18 says, when the Son of Man comes, he will not be looking for those who believe, but he will be looking for faith. I want that when Jesus comes, he will find me faithful. Imperfect, impure, struggling as I might be, I want not only to believe, I want to act on what I believe. I want God to activate, energize, revive, infuse life into what I believe. I want God to turn my passive belief into active faith. That's what I want for myself. There's only one who can do that for me. And his name is Jesus. That's why today I have nothing to give you, but I give you Jesus. He's still the same. Jesus is still the rock of ages. He is still Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. Jesus is still the fairest of 10,000, the lily of the valley. Yes, he is the bread of life, the water of life, the fountain of life. Yes, Jesus is King of kings, Lord of lords. At his name, every knee shall bow and confess that Jesus is Lord. If you want to transform and activate your belief from its passivity into an active faith, only Jesus can do that for you. So as I stand before you, I want to pray and say, Lord, activate my belief and help me to live by faith here on. If that is your desire also, I invite you to stand while we pray together. Almighty God, we stand together today because we recognize that believing is important. But Lord, we don't want to be passive believers. We are asking you, Jesus, through your Holy Spirit, to activate our belief and transform it into faith so that our lives can be a testimony to the world of how great you are. Lord, may our relationship with you condition our faith, Lord. Like Matthew, who claimed ownership of my car because of his relationship with me. Because of our relationship with you, Lord, because you are our Father, in faith, Lord, we reach out today and we say, Lord, Lord, do for us what no one else can do. Activate our belief and transform it into faith. May we leave this house of worship today, not as believers, but as faithful believers. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Go. Yeah.